Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Goddess, Blessed Reunions with the Feminine Face of the Divine by Anodea Judith. Narrated by Randye Kaye. Disclaimer. The information provided in this book is designed to provide helpful information on the subjects discussed. This book is not meant to be used, nor should it be used, to diagnose or treat any medical condition. The author and publisher are not responsible for any specific health needs that may require medical supervision and are not liable for any damages or negative consequences from any treatment, action, application, or preparation to any person reading or following the information in this book. References are provided for information purposes only and do not constitute endorsement of any individuals, websites, or other sources. In the event you use any of the information in this book for yourself, the author and the publisher assume no responsibility for your actions. Part 1. Meeting the Goddess. A religion without a goddess is halfway to atheism. Dion Fortune. Opening the Way. Since the beginning of language, humans have told stories to explain the mysteries that surround us. When our lives were deeply embedded in nature, those stories were about the sun and the moon, the cycles of birth, life and death, and the balance in all of life. They gave meaning to people's lives and provided a moral guide for their behavior. Through stories, humans found connection to each other and to something greater than themselves as part of a deeply interconnected web of life. As time progressed, science and technology eroded our connection to the natural world, and most of those stories drifted into the past. Rational explanations replaced the more intuitive and imaginal realms in which stories live. While humanity took a giant step forward with the advance of science and rationality, we lost something precious in the process. Myth represents the other leg upon which we stand. We cannot take the next step forward without guiding myths to give us meaning and direction. Nor can we move forward without a feminine face of the divine to balance and partner with the masculine paradigm. Science tells us what and how, but not why. It allows us to manipulate the world around us, bending life to our will. It reveals the tiniest of particles and reaches to the far edges of the universe. But science does not tell us what makes these parts into a whole. It does not tell us what it means to be alive or why we are here. It's as if we were trying to understand our economic system by analyzing the ink on the dollar. Without myths to guide us, humanity is losing its way. An essential element of the sacred is lost. Myths are not true stories in the rational sense, yet they explore larger and deeper truths. They explain things on an archetypal level. Archetypes, from the Greek root archi, meaning first, and typos, to strike a blow, as in a blacksmith fashioning iron, are the primary imprints of consciousness, in turn shaping culture and its values. Invisible yet powerful forces behind our beliefs and behaviors, archetypes define who we are, both individually and collectively, but even more, they define who we can be. The goddess is an essential archetype at the heart of all existence. To learn about her is to explore, at an archetypal level, a necessary part of ourselves and a missing part of our world. Embracing the goddess allows us to reclaim magic and mystery, to re-engage with enchantment, love, and beauty, to delight in imagination and creativity, and to ground ourselves once again in the sacred wholeness of nature. Through the goddess, we can return from whence we came. each of us goes home, not as a helpless child suckling on the mother's breast, but as a maturing adult co-creating with the feminine face of the divine. To return home is to come back down to earth and reclaim our roots, at last integrating heaven and earth in a seamless, intelligent cosmology of a living universe. To heal is to become whole, as these two words are from the same root. Our fractured civilization will never find its wholeness in a purely masculine paradigm, in a singular male godhead, or in the denial of what brings us joy, meaning, and connection. It is not that the masculine is evil or bad, for it has created many of the wonders we have today. It's given us our highways and railroads, hospitals and airports, computers, stereos, and cell phones. The problem with the masculine paradigm is that it lacks balance when it has no feminine to dance with. To conceive a new life requires both masculine and feminine energies, but it takes a woman to give birth to that life, and preferably two parents to raise a child. Without a goddess alongside a god, we cannot create the divine partnership necessary to conceive, give birth, and successfully parent a new world. This book is a resource for finding the goddess once again. In its chapters, you will find her feminine face peeking out at you through history and myth, in contemporary stories and personal experiences of women and men who have encountered her. You will get an overview of what the goddess is all about, who she is in her diverse aspects as the maiden, mother, crone, and queen, and what she can do for your life and for our world. Simple practices will help you connect once again to the goddess that has always been there, in her varied expressions from cultures around the world. As you find her within, you will also strengthen her presence in the world. This book is about reclaiming the goddess so she can return to our world. But it's not so much that she needs to return to us, but that we need to come back home to her. She has always been here. It is we who have strayed. The masculine paradigm has taken us on a hero's journey, a pattern outlined by Joseph Campbell and reflected in myths and stories all over the world. In this journey, we leave the ordinary world for the call of adventure. We meet mentors, face challenges, go through ordeals, and seek the reward of transformation. But the final step in the hero's journey is the return home, bringing back the elixir of healing to an ailing community. It is time, at last, to return home to the goddess and drink deep of her elixir of healing, love, beauty, and compassion. Are you ready to lift the veil, to see a world that has been forgotten, yet has been under your nose all along? Are you ready to embrace the passion of your life force, regain the full spectrum of possibilities, and help bring not only balance, but beauty and magic back to our world? Then there's someone I can't wait to introduce you to. Who is the goddess? Who is this goddess whose name has long been stripped from our lips? Who is this feminine face of creation, this lady with laughing eyes, swishing her colorful skirts as she dances in the breeze? Is she one or many, human or divine? Is she eternal or is she constantly changing? Is she within or without? And why is her soft touch and deep wisdom so missing in our world? The goddess may be long forgotten, yet you already know her. She is the mother who bore you, the smile on your sister's face, the grandmother who winks at you from behind her wrinkles. She is the beauty of the green earth and the silvery light of the moon. She is the flowers blossoming in spring and the ripe fruits of the fall harvest. She is the mystery of birth and death and the lover who embraces all that lies between. She is you and me and all living things, the animals, the plants, the mountains, and the forests. She is the incessant manifestation of nature in all its myriad expressions. To meet her is not only to love her, but to be embraced by her love in return. She does not judge or punish, but, like a mother to a child, offers compassion when we stumble. She eschews sameness and conformity, expressing herself through wide diversity where all are worthy within her vast creation. Her flowers and fruits express her abundance, for she always creates more than enough and never requires proof of our worthiness to partake of her creation. She is both immanent and transcendent, simultaneously within you and all around you. Her song is the song of creation, transformation, and completion, all within a cyclic spiral of time. The goddess is the expression of the divine feminine, present in all life, and reflected in the beauty of the natural world, the cycle of the seasons, and the stages of one's life. She is Mother Earth and Sister Moon. She is the queen of heaven, as well as the queen of the underworld. She is the temple of the body and the ground of being, which we are all privileged to experience and to hold as sacred. She is unconditional love. Hers is a gentle but all-pervasive power, ruled by an eternal wisdom. As the ultimate mystery of the feminine face of the divine, she beckons us to probe deeper into the mystery, never to be fully revealed. From the One to the Many. All myths and religions describe some kind of initial division of the ultimate source as it breaks down into expression in the manifested world. Inanna's descent to the underworld, the oldest written myth we know of, begins with the division of heaven and earth. Zoroastrianism describes the division of good and evil as the realm of two competing brothers. The Bible tells us that light emerged from darkness. It's no wonder, then, that the ultimate source of everything divides itself into the masculine and feminine expressions that run through all biological life. In this division, the goddess represents half of all creation. She is both the originator and the underlying field of manifestation upon which all of creation plays. From her feminine field, she manifests in many forms, worshipped in cultures around the world. Just as we were all conceived by a mother and a father, then birthed from the womb of a mother, the goddess can be seen as the one who breathes spirit into material existence. She takes the pattern from the DNA of the father, same root as pater or father, and brings it into matter, creating the flesh of a living child, same root as mater, mother. Rather than abstract and conceptual, she is tangible and real. One need not believe in her any more than we believe in rocks and trees. We know them as reality. Her glory is in the phenomenal world we live in, not in the abstract hereafter. As the goddess was devalued in patriarchal religions, matter was deemed spiritually inferior, along with the earth and our physical bodies, leading to serious consequences for our biosphere. In goddess religion, the beauty of nature is not regarded as illusion or base materialism, but as a living expression of supreme intelligence. The goddess did not fall from grace, for the earth is her temple. Instead, she rises from the earth year after year to sustain us and bring us her countless blessings. In a similar vein, the physical body is seen as a sacred vessel for her divine essence, for she dwells within everything. Her way is not one of denial, asceticism, or self-inflicted suffering, but of celebration and joy. In goddess worship, it is said that all acts of love and pleasure are her rituals, and sacred sexuality is viewed as a sacrament, not a sin. The goddess is the basic field upon which all life is played. She is a creatrix by virtue of her ability to give birth, nurturer by her ability to sustain life, destroyer by her natural limits that bring us all eventually to death. The goddess is the miracle of the life force in all creation, as well as creation itself. She is found in the vastness of all existence and the unknown depths of our psyche. As the divine feminine, the goddess is present in all women. She is the divine spark within you, and she is within me as I write, love, and live. She lives in your sister, your mother, and your daughter, as well as existing within your lovers and sons, fathers, and brothers. As the force of nature, she is cyclic rather than linear. She spirals in the endless pattern of birth, growth, death, and rebirth. Each verse of the song a little more complex than the last, ever evolving toward a crescendo in her symphony of life. As a generatrix of cycles, her worship is always in the round, in living room circles, in groves of trees, and the organic shapes of the natural world. Her circle is inclusive rather than exclusive, egalitarian rather than hierarchical, collaborative rather than controlling. Unlike the patriarchal religions that teach us transcendence, the goddess is seen as immanent, meaning that she is found right here within everything around us rather than out there. She is the force within the tree, the mountain, the animals, and plants. Let's return to the idea of archetypes. An archetype is a basic pattern of expression of divine energy, such as the archetype of the hero, the wise woman, or the great mother. Within an archetype are subtle variations of individuality. Just as we are all familiar with the archetype of a mother as a generality, an individual mother might be kind or cruel, loving or withholding. I like to think of the archetypes as dresses in the goddess's closet. Some days, she puts on her dress of the healer, and other days, she wears a sexy dress to become the maiden or lover. On other occasions, she wears the dress of spring flowers or the starry night sky. And for special occasions, she wears no dress at all and dances in naked splendor for all to enjoy. Then we experience her raw power that is beyond any manifestation. As an archetype, she is a symbol for various aspects of feminine existence. Like any religious symbol, goddess is only a representation. The archetype is not the goddess herself, but something that allows us to conceptualize her. Archetypes like the Great Mother, the Wild Woman, or the Queen give us a form to relate to within ourselves. By understanding them, we find these dresses hanging in the closets of our own psyches, where we have direct access to them. When we put on those dresses, enacting the archetype through a living being, the goddess comes to life. Knowing the archetypes gives us permission to fill out our own being in her many diverse expressions. In living these archetypes, we give the goddess expression. Reflecting stages of a woman's life, she represents the holy trinity of maiden, mother, and crone, commonly referred to as the triple goddess. A fourth category, that of the queen, is relevant to women who choose to pursue a career. It is to these distinctions that we turn our attention next. Triple Goddess Plus One. The maiden reflects the innocence of the young girl. She is the virgin. However, in times past, this did not imply a woman who had never had sex, but one who belonged to herself, having not yet given herself in marriage or to children. This phase of the goddess correlates to springtime, to beginnings, and to the new and crescent moon. The next archetypal phase of the goddess is the mother, for once a woman gives birth, she never again belongs to herself alone, even when her children are grown. This phase represents the fecundity of Mother Earth, the season of summer's ripeness and the fall harvest, the full moon, and the time of a woman's life when she creates, nurtures, and sustains. The third archetypal phase is the crone or wise woman. She represents the ending of the cycle and the finality of death. The crone brings a deep wisdom born of living. She rules over winter, nighttime, and the dark of the moon. A fourth archetype that we will explore is the queen. In today's world, many women choose a career over childbearing. Others live long, healthy lives after raising children, creating a potent period of midlife relating to the queen, not as a dignitary sitting on a throne next to her husband, but as a woman in the maturity of her power, presiding over complexity and making a notable contribution. As we explore the goddess in these chapters, we will delve deeply into each phase, giving examples of goddesses along with their stories and the beliefs connected to them. We will begin with the mother, since all things begin with birth. We will then explore the crone as we examine the demise of the goddess, the death of her reign, and the incredible loss and suffering that followed. We will then turn to the maiden as we explore the resurgence of the goddess in modern times and the necessary balance and hope that she brings. And finally, we will visit the queen and explore this powerful aspect of the goddess as a benign ruler. As we explore these archetypes, we discover the goddess is far more than just an idea. She cannot be reduced to an abstraction, a theological construct, or a set of beliefs, for to do so would take away her power and substance, qualities that are inherent to her being. She is a substantial reality, as real as the baby crying with her first breath, as real as the miracle of springtime, as real as the rocks and trees outside. I don't believe in the goddess. I know her. I have touched her and smelled her. I have heard her voice in my inner ear. I have been teased by her mysteries, chided with her lessons, and blessed by her magic. She is not a concept, but a living, direct experience, present every day and night in all that we see and do. This book is intended to lead you to the direct experience of the goddess, to rekindle the connection to the divine feminine that is everywhere around you, and bring about actualization of the goddess within you. Does deity have a gender? The goddess is not God in drag. She's not Jehovah in a skirt. In fact, she is not a single entity at all, but represents a wide range of expressions that serves both men and women. It's crucially important to the goddess, to women, and to the culture we live in that men also get involved in the religion of the goddess. In so doing, they will not only help the state of the earth and the status of their mothers, sisters, and daughters, but they will regain their own sacredness, strength, power, and divinity with more freedom to express who they really are. In so doing, they just might recognize the feminine face of the divine in their sisters and partners and allow more of it within themselves. Many noteworthy movers and shakers in the goddess movement have been men. Mythologist Joseph Campbell, historian Mircea Eliade, archaeologist James Mellart, and the founding fathers of the modern pagan revival, such as Gerald Gardner, Oberon Zell, or Isaac Bonowitz. These men have revived, worshipped, and helped foster understanding of the goddess. Echoing from the beginning of time, the biological, cultural, and cosmic forces of masculine and feminine are fundamental aspects to our psyche and our world. From the moment we take our first breath, our identity and behavior are profoundly shaped by our biology and its cultural associations. A child's first definition of self may be, I'm a girl or I'm a boy, and as they develop, their personality is expected to fall in line with the expectations for that gender. We learn to decipher what is me and not me, as if being male or female means rejecting its opposite. This is more pronounced for men, who face sharper criticism for exhibiting feminine behavior than women do for being masculine. Few assumptions are buried so deeply in the collective as our definitions of masculine and feminine. Every culture has them, though they vary across the globe and through different eras of history. Victorian women wore fluffy petticoats and tight corsets, something few women anywhere would do today. Men risk ostracism and sometimes fatal attacks for being gay or effeminate. Muslim women under the Taliban risk losing their lives for attending school or letting their hair fly freely. Men are expected to be tough, powerful, and accomplished, while women are expected to be supportive, kind, and compassionate. Unconsciously programmed to think dualistically, we compute all our information through a value system of either-or, good-evil, win-lose, light-dark, and of course, male-female. While useful in a crude way, this system promotes rigid definitions and leaves little room for the great realm of in-between. There have always been individuals in any culture who find definitions of male and female to be too limiting, knowing their truer selves to be more androgynous, gender fluid, or beyond gender. They might change their gender to better suit who they experience themselves to be. Others may be happy to identify as male or female, but want more freedom to express themselves in ways that might be considered out of the box for their gender. If you look at the way younger generations are showing up today, gender is undergoing profound transformations and finding expression in new and exciting ways. Given these cultural changes, what does it mean to attribute gender to the divine? Does it limit or expand the divine to assign words like God or goddess? Does something so ineffable as the divine force even have qualities that are masculine and feminine? If so, how does that come to be, and why is it important? What are the downstream effects of a religion in which the highest overarching principle is deemed to be either male or female? If God is a masculine he, as assumed by the major Abrahamic religions of Christianity, Judaism, and Islam, what does that mean for the cultures that live with that assumption? What does it mean for a society of both men and women, boys and girls, and all the in-betweens to ignore the feminine aspect of the divine and worship only the masculine? What moral compass does that provide for society? What do we gain, and what do we lose? Pondering the nature of the divine is the subject of deep theological inquiry, but even the word theology refers to the study of the masculine divine as theos. Instead, theology, with an A based on the word thea, is the study of the divine feminine or goddess, a word that was introduced in the 70s and came into acceptance in 1996. In a culture where the divine is masculine, it is believed that men are made in God's image. When the priesthood is male, women's contributions go missing. They are omitted from shaping the doctrines, practices, and moral tenets of religion and society. Not only are women given inferior status, but feminine qualities are missing from religion, boardrooms, hospitals, banking industries, food production, and most of the major aspects of our society. In religions where God is a he, there is little of the feminine at all, whether mortal or divine. There is no mother, no wife, no sister, no daughter. There is no counterpart, therefore no co-creation, no sacred marriage of opposites. In fact, no marriage at all. The result for a society that lives within this kind of house of God is that we are living in a broken home. It's as if the mother was divorced or deceased and was never to be mentioned again. Meanwhile, we are parented by a strict, single father who doesn't even date and certainly doesn't have sex. As a monotheistic godhead, this god rules alone and is jealous of all others. In goddess theology, the goddess is both an overarching concept of unity and an expression of diversity. As such, she not only includes the masculine, but embraces him as the cosmic dance partner necessary for co-creation of all that is. As Patricia Monahan states in her book, The Goddess Path, goddess religion throughout historical times not only encouraged belief in male divinity, it required it. Like the goddess, the masculine divine is also simultaneously transcendent and immanent, also young and old, light and dark, feminine and masculine. A key point worth repeating. Goddess religion is inclusive rather than exclusive. While it does contain sects, such as the Dianics, who may choose to worship the feminine alone, this is not characteristic of the larger goddess movement. This inclusivity not only gives equal status to both men and women, but it also encourages the integration of masculine and feminine within each of us, granting more freedom to express who we really are. It's fine to consider an abstract, gender-neutral aspect of the divine, but if that androgynous entity does not include the feminine, it negates more than it includes. What is important about the goddess is that she represents curves and colors, love and beauty, life and death. She is cyclic rather than linear, inclusive rather than exclusive. Her forms are as varied as men and women themselves, as varied as the flowers in the fields or the beasts in the forests. She never takes a single expression, never requires conformity, is never hierarchical. She is unity in diversity, more heart than mind. To deny the feminine face of the divine is to deny all these things. It is to deny the myriad expressions within nature, the richness of diversity, and the expansive expression of life itself. The goddess is not abstract, androgynous, or disembodied. She can be as fierce as the volcanoes of the Hawaiian goddess Pele. And she can also be as delicate as the Welsh goddess Bloodwet's body of flowers. To embrace the goddess is to reclaim the values of the feminine into our world and make them sacred once again. It is to bring back pageantry with its colorful costumes, music, and dance. It is to reclaim the celebration of the human body with the pleasure of sexuality, the joy and the laughter of a romping good time, and the creativity of expression that has no limits. And what of the men who run with women who run with the goddess? They are dancers and lovers, fathers and mates, leaders and followers, priests and teachers. They are men who see themselves not as a disembodied abstract entity, but as masculine expressions of the divine, such as the sun god, the green man, or the horned one. Men who love the feminine don't need to fear it within themselves or from their lovers, co-workers, and co-creators. They have more freedom to be who they are and express their maleness in a way that feels whole and healthy, spanning a wide range of diversity. Such men run in the company of women who are wild and free, powerful women who know who they are, carry their own weight, and earn their own money. They are men who enjoy the continuous interplay between the god and goddess, one that allows them to experience themselves and their partner as divine. With a positive emphasis on sexuality, men in this religion are more likely to have a diversity of lovers, male or female, or none according to their preference. They need not feel shame for their sexuality, but embrace it, whether straight, gay, or bisexual. Most goddess-loving people worship a polytheistic parade of both gods and goddesses and have a more or less balanced number of men and women participating. I can speak from experience that the men in this movement are happy walking among goddesses and being treated like gods. Gay men are comfortable celebrating both god and goddess in themselves and each other, or embracing their own feminine without fear or shame. The values expressed in goddess theology enable men to return to their bodies and their feelings, where they can reclaim their sexuality and their creative power in a way that honors their basic nature. They return to a god different from the one they may have learned about as a child. The god who dances with the goddess is not a patriarch. He is not an all-powerful and all-knowing ruler and controller. He is an ancient dancer from an earlier time, a god who walked in harmony with the goddess and ruled beside her in co-creation, balance, and protection of all life. As the god is consort to the goddess, he is her delight and her renewal. He is her initiator, warrior, priest, magician, king, and especially her lover. As father, he is the other end of childcare. As elder, he is guide and teacher. As youth, he is erotic delight, the fire of enthusiasm, and the inspiration of new ideas. Men who love the goddess are loved by her in return. Thus, the cycle is made whole within and without. It is from this spiritual perspective that we birth a new world. Exploring the Ancient Roots of the Mother. Few people remember the circumstances of their birth, yet its effect on the psyche is profound. Your birth may have been easy or complicated, celebrated with joy or trepidation, a natural birth or a C-section. But like everyone else, you came into this world through the womb of a mother. If you were fortunate enough to have had a good mother, one who supported you, cared for you, and loved you through life, you remember her fondly. You may also remember the times she was angry, overwhelmed, or strict, and you understand this archetype in all her complexity. She had a light and a dark side, good days and bad, but as an archetype, rather than a stereotype, she had dimensions that made her unique. Human culture also began with a mother, though she is long forgotten today. Birthed from the primal womb of nature, we spent our cultural infancy surrounded by her plants and animals, wandering her forests and fields. Her abundant breast provided our nourishment, free for the asking. As our ancestors witnessed the miracle of a woman's swollen belly producing life, they noticed that plants and animals did the same. It was a logical jump to see Earth as a divine mother with powers far beyond our understanding. Her gifts were a magnificent mystery, a source of awe and wonder. Like our own mothers, this primordial goddess could be kind or cruel. She could grant life, but she could also snip it away in an instant. We obeyed her laws to survive. The caves we lived in were like wombs of warmth and protection for the tribe. From that safety of the mother, we wandered forth as we grew and prospered during our cultural infancy. The mother is the center of attention to the infant who is dependent upon her. She is the source of all our needs, the anchor of safety and protection, and the steady home base that gives us security and trust. We cannot go very far from her side and still survive. This phase of infancy is essential to our wholeness. When it goes well, we have a secure foundation upon which to build our lives. Our distant ancestors considered the mother goddess the center of life itself, the sole source of everything. as we were surrounded by the natural world, unbroken as far as we could see. Mother Nature was the foundation of all life. That makes this aspect of the goddess the common ground to us all. But just as we have little or no memory of our birth and early life, humanity has forgotten its origins and once prevalent worship of the mother goddess. As individuals, we can rely on stories from grandparents and family members to learn about our origin. As a culture, we turn to modern discoveries in archaeology that have unearthed evidence of a widespread worship of the goddess as mother. Reaching back through.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.